Jay GaBany give our talk. He's known for his work with an international team of astrophysicists led by Dr. David Martinez Delgado with the University of Heidelberg. He helped pioneer astrophotography to produce long exposure images that reveal ancient galactic merger remnants in the form of star streams surrounding nearby galaxies that were previously unexpected and undetected. He typically spends 100 to 500 hours of his time to process an image to get out these very faint details. He's co-authored over 14 peer-reviewed scientific papers, and he won the Chambliss Award by the American Astronomical Society. If you visit his website, put in his name, you'll go to Cosmotography. You'll be amazed at the images he's taken. Some of them are interactive. I'm sure many he'll share with us tonight. You can see the huge number of publications that have featured his work, including many times on the APOD, Astronomy Picture of the Day, which I recommend you go every day to view that. So right now I want you to think of a Hubble galaxy image that you're familiar with. When Jay GaBany spoke to us in 2007, he showed the result of what the galaxy really looked like after his long image acquisition and processing. He then processed the image of the same object from other people who'd gathered the same data with their CCD cameras to be sure he was right. And he was. In 2007, he received an astonished SFAA standing ovation from the club when he showed the first image that he had worked on. Since then, we're used to seeing his lovely images in many sources, and he continues to work on it. At the time, he was asked in 2007 not to show his images until the ongoing collaboration with that international team of professional astronomers could confirm and work with the research results. So there was a period where we weren't seeing these things. He demonstrated the scientific potential of using modest aperture, commercially produced, semi-robotic telescopes situated under steady dark skies, using affordable, off-the-shelf astronomical cameras to reveal these extremely dim, faint, diffuse structures. His work sheds highlights on galactic evolution, and this presentation will share the techniques, experience, and highlights of his investigation so far. I'm so pleased you're here tonight to hear it. Welcome, Jay GaBany.
Linda, that was a wonderful introduction. Thank you very much. I hope I live up to it. Thank you for having me. I think this is the third time I've spoken to this group, and I really enjoy it, and I keep coming back for more. So thank you for having me. Is it possible we could dim the lights or get rid of some of the lights? Because some of these images, you're just not going to be able to appreciate them with all this light. That's better. Good. Thank you. So what I want to talk about this evening is, as Linda mentioned, some work that I've done with an international team of astrophysicists, astronomers, who contacted me in 2006 by email, just clearly out of the blue, and in response to an image they had seen on my website, and asked if I'd like to work with them. And I said yes. You know, of course, what do you have to lose? And I figured after the first project that that would be the last I heard of them, and they kept coming back. And so I've been working with them consistently since 2006 on just one after another projects. And what I want to show you is some of the results of all that work. And I want to get you to consider, does it really take big instruments to do big science? So here's my agenda. First, we're going to talk about does big science equal big instruments? Second, we're going to talk about doing some galactic archaeology using modest instruments. And by modest, I mean small, stuff that you yourself could afford to own, or you and maybe a friend together could afford to own. And also go into the question of how did galaxies evolve? Because fundamentally, that's the research that this team, a scientific team I work with, is interested in. And then finally, I'll share some results of all this research. So does big science equal big instruments? For instance, here's a, it's not a picture, it's a rendition of the 30-meter telescope that is still planned for Mauna Kea, but as very recently, the board of directors have started to think maybe we're not going to be able to get this thing built up there, and they're thinking now of the Canary Islands. And the 2022 date is also now sort of in question, but they still plan to build it. Either it would be in Hawaii, or it'll be over off the coast of Africa. But it's a big telescope, 30 meters. A 98-foot diameter primary. Okay. Currently, the world's largest telescope is the Grand Teton. It's in the Canary Islands on the island of Tenerife. And I've actually been to this telescope, and in fact, I took this picture, and it is as tall as a 36-story building. Back when I was much younger, I had the opportunity of visiting Cape Kennedy, which is what it was called back then, and to see one of the Apollo Saturn V moon rockets. And that was also about 36 stories tall. So this is a big telescope. It's the height of a 14-story building, and it has a 34-foot primary mirror. Then there's Keck 1 and Keck 2. These are also big telescopes. They're over in Hawaii, on Mauna Kea. And each of these telescopes has a 33-foot primary mirror. So again, very big, right? There's a Subaru telescope on Mauna Kea. It has a 27-foot diameter primary mirror. In 2018, they're planning to launch the James Webb Space Telescope, you know, which is to eventually replace the Hubble. Right, it has a 21-foot diameter primary mirror. That's a big telescope to be put into space. Of course, there's the classic Hale telescope, Mount Palomar, 17-foot mirror. Right, and then the Hubble Space Telescope itself, which produces all those wonderful pictures, it has an 8-foot primary mirror. And you know, you've seen some of the pictures. You know, this is a picture of Io taken by the Keck. You know, you can see surface features on this moon. They regularly take observations of it to see, look for activity. This is a picture of NGC 6946 by the Subaru. The Hale telescope took this classic view of the Orion Nebula. And the Hubble Space Telescope, this is a very famous view of the Eagle Nebula. So what are the advantages of a big telescope? Well, first of all, they've got great resolution. They can see very small details. They have tremendous light gathering power. You know, they are literally light buckets. You know, in seconds, they can gather, they can go 100,000 times dimmer than the human eye can see in just seconds of an exposure. They generally are equipped with the latest technology. They're located under incredibly dark, clear skies because they cost so much and they want to make sure they can get the most use of them. And for the space telescopes, you know, they're above the atmosphere and they get these, you know, just amazing views that can't be rivaled by anything on the ground. So there is a big advantage to these large telescopes. But you know, small telescopes also have some advantages. And, you know, small telescopes have made scientific contributions over the years. For instance, you know, Galileo discovered lunar craters, the moons of Jupiter, sunspots, and he had a 1-inch telescope, right? William Herschel discovered Uranus with a 6-inch telescope. And Messier, you know, the famous comet hunter, you know, found all those nebulas with just a 4-inch telescope. I mean, this is a small, modest telescope. So small telescopes have made huge contributions to science over the centuries. And today, small telescopes, modest telescopes, are being used to do variable star research. They're discovering exoplanets. They are the primary source of new comet discoveries, and they also are discovering planetary events. For instance, two times a small telescope discovered comets hitting Jupiter just within the past couple decades. So small telescopes can make a contribution, and they are continuing to make a contribution. Now, this is my telescope. I call it the Blackbird Telescope. It's located here in California in a place called Alder Springs. Alder Springs is located up in the Sierra Nevada Mountains, somewhere between King Canyon and Yosemite National Park. And my telescope has a 1.6-foot diameter mirror. It's considered, compared to the big telescopes, it's modest. But here's some of the pictures I've taken with it. This is M104, and the red filaments you see coming out of the center of M104 are actually from a supermassive black hole. These are jets that, as M104 has turned over the millions of years, the billions of years, the spray of that jet has become skewed. And that's why it is splayed out like that. Here's the Perseus Galaxy Cluster. Here's the Trifid Nebula. This is a combination of the Christmas Tree Cluster, the Foxfur Nebula, and the Cone Nebula. These are all taken with my 1.6-foot telescope. Here's the Lagoon Nebula.
Question.
Yes?
Do you do anything else to make it look like this? Photos?
Well, I process them.
Processing,
just to be brief, because I want to sort of stay on track, literally with both amateur and professional telescopes, color pictures are created from taking black and white grayscale images through different colored filters, a red, blue, and a green. Okay, so to create this picture, I had to produce 4 exposures. One through a red filter, one through a green filter, one through a blue filter, and then one through a clear filter to get the luminance. Okay, each of the exposures, for instance, for this particular picture lasted, probably about 15 hours. Okay, now it wasn't one single 15-hour exposure. It was a series of 30-minute exposures that were combined digitally to create the equivalent of a 15, right? And then the call sign, I know which filter each of the images represent, through a computer, you can simply project that color back into that photograph. You blend them together, and you get the actual color. So one of the questions I get asked a lot is, are those colors real? And they are. They're very much real. It's just that your eyes would never see them, even if you look through the world's largest telescope. And then, of course, here's the Horsehead Nebula. So, like I said, my observatory is located up in the Sierra Nevada Mountains, just slightly east of Fresno. It's totally remotely operated. I operate it from my house. I live in San Jose. It's like a 4-hour drive to get to my telescope, so there's no way I'd go there often enough to actually take all these pictures. And I'm at about 4,600 feet above sea level. It has exceptionally dark skies and exceptionally steady skies, meaning when I've gone there, the stars don't twinkle. They look like they're just sort of nailed to the sky. They just don't, and that's actually desirable when you're taking these photographs, because twinkling stars means the atmosphere is busy and the image through a telescope becomes smeared, so that you lose detail. It's, you know, it's my observatory is equipped with a it's basically a half meter Richard Creightonian telescope. Richard Creightonian is the same style of telescope used by all the modern large observatories, has been for decades. And I also have a 16 megapixel camera made by a company called Apogee. And it's all, this is all off the shelf. There's nothing custom about that telescope. That telescope is being manufactured by a company over in Italy. And if you want one, you can have one just like it. And the camera is also, it's off the shelf. So there's nothing fancy going on here. And that's a picture of the camera, what the camera looks like. And as I said, it does not take color pictures, it takes black and white pictures. But I take those images through filters and then recombine them to create the color. Now, let me give you some comparisons of aperture that we're talking about. At the top is the Grand Teton, which is the world's largest telescope right now. Below that's the Keck, and then the Subaru, right? These are the ones that we talked about just a bit earlier. Then the James Webb, the Hale, and these are all expressed in inches, right? And then the Hubble, and then mine, that little dot, and in case you can't see it, it's right there. And then the 30 meter, right? And then that, compare that to a regulation tennis court and a regulation basketball court, get some size of how big these telescopes are. So the 30 meter is planning on being about the size of a basketball court. Huge. And you know, of course, now the 30 meter, the Subaru, not the Subaru, the Keck and the Grand Teton are all segment telescopes, and as they're not solid, they're made up of a series of hexagonal units that are held in place to a precision of you know, a wavelength of light, so that they act like a single solid piece of glass or solid mirror. But again, even one of the segments of these telescopes is bigger than my telescope.
Question?
Yeah.
What is the largest telescope with a single piece of glass? Is that
the Hale? No, it would actually be, the Hale's 200 inches and the Subaru is 323 inches, and so the Subaru would be bigger than the Hale.
Oh, that's not a segment?
No, the Subaru's a solid piece of glass. Okay, so that's sort of an overview of does big science equal big instruments? And my answer to that question is no, doesn't. So let me talk now about galactic archaeology using small instruments, and talk a little bit about how did galaxies evolve in the first place? Because this is the question that, again, the team of scientists I work with are trying to answer. Before we get into that, let's ask this question. Why would professional astronomers want to work with someone who has a small telescope to conduct galactic research, right? And because galaxies are very faint to begin with. And you would think that if you want to go take a picture of something very faint, you'd want to use an instrument that can gather as much light as possible. Okay, so one of the reasons that these scientists are willing to work with someone like me is because they don't have a lot of access to the big instruments. One of the challenges in astronomy, if you're a professional, is that it's very hard to actually use a big telescope. To get time on a big telescope, you've got to write a proposal, you submit it, and of course there's like hundreds of other people submitting proposals to use that same telescope. A committee reviews your proposal, compares it to the other proposal, decides if yours has merit, meaning if you're successful in your research, will it bring glory to this telescope and therefore make it more desirable for more people to use our telescope, right? So let's say then you are selected. So you're assigned a date, and that date may be 6 months from now, and you're giving two nights. That's all, because that's all they can spare. In fact, with the Subaru, you're limited to three nights per year. That's the most you can use a Subaru, right? So then you wait, and on your nights, the weather's terrible. You can't use a telescope because it's raining. So what happens to you? Well, tough luck. Submit your proposal again, stand in line, and hopefully you'll get selected for next year. So it's very difficult. There are more professional astronomers than there are big research telescopes. Second problem with using these big telescopes is that we're talking about structures that are very, very faint. And that's because they're so far away, and intrinsically, they're not very bright to begin with. And one of the challenges it means that even with a very big instrument, you need to take a long exposure, okay? And sometimes that exposure that's required is longer than you have time on the telescope. In other words, it can't be done in just a night. It can't be done in two nights, okay? So that's a challenge. These big telescopes also don't take the best pictures of faint objects. There is a function that you do when you use a telescope called a flat field. You have to take a flat field. And what a flat field is after you finish taking your exposures at night, you need to take a picture of the reflections inside the telescope so that those reflections can be subtracted from the deep image you took that night, okay? And the result is you'll get a nice black, flat background. If you don't do this flat field thing, your background will be full of, I call it grunge, just noise. It'll be ripples and all this kind of stuff, and flares. And basically, it'll make your deep image, this deep exposure you took, useless. Well, the problem with these large telescopes is they have flat field issues. It's very hard to get a nice, perfect flat field image with a big telescope. And so even with some of these really large telescopes, and I'm saying this from experience because I've had to work with some of these images that have been taken with big telescopes, they do not result in a nice black, flat background. And of course, any noise that's in the background of one of these deep images will mask or hide these very faint structures. You just won't be able to see them because there's noise hiding them. It's like a veil. Conversely, someone who has a private observatory, such as myself, I don't have any restrictions. I can use it 365 days a year if I want. Literally, anytime it's clear, I can go use that telescope. I don't have to stand in line with anybody. It's mine. So by working with these scientists, and these scientists work with me, they literally have almost unlimited access to a telescope. And they like that, because that way we can take really long exposures. Sometimes these exposures go on for weeks to gather up enough light. Also, a small instrument like what I have has a larger field of view. In other words, with my telescope, I can capture a piece of the sky that's the size of the full moon, which is 30 arc minutes square, right? The bigger the instrument, the bigger the telescope, the smaller the field of view, okay? So that an instrument, say like the Keck can maybe capture a field of view that's a fifth that size. All right, so the problem is, some of these galaxies and some of these star streams, right, are bigger than the field of view of these large telescopes. In other words, they can't capture the whole thing. They have to create a mosaic. They have to take this part of it, and then this part of it, and this part of it. So now this is why, again, there's not enough time on these big telescopes to go and create these deep exposures four times so you can try to encompass the whole thing.
Is that a problem of the telescope or the detector, the big telescopes?
No, it's a problem. It's a matter of physics. It's just the fact that, you know, the larger the aperture, the smaller the field of view. I mean, you can adjust that somewhat with F ratio, right? The lower your F ratio, the bigger the field of view. But there's a certain point where you can't take any further. And again, a small instrument like what I've got, you know, I can capture some of the size of the moon, you know, and go very deep and with fairly good resolution. And finally, you know, science or technology has come so far now that, you know, even telescopes like mine, you know, a little 20-inch pea shooter compared to these other telescopes, I can go down to something to Mag 27, okay? And I'm saying that because we've done some, they've taken my images and they've actually analyzed them to see exactly how deep are we getting here. And, you know, we reached a little bit above Mag 27. And back in the 80s, you know, the hail was said to have gone, you know, maybe Mag 22, Mag 23. So the technology and the cameras, these off-the-shelf cameras like what I've got, has improved to the point that it rivals what the big guys can do. So let's talk about something called the standard model. You know, standard model is the way, is a reference to how science describes the formation of the universe. You know, how did the universe form? You know, the standard model says that the universe evolved hierarchically, meaning that small units combined to make bigger units. In other words, galaxies were originally very small, but they were numerous. And over time, after the Big Bang, they started to merge. And as they merged, they became bigger. And so hierarchically, they grew, right? And they were shaped and formed by tidal interactions and mergers. Those were the two basic ways that they grew and were shaped. So what caused them to form? Well, first of all, gravity did. Gravity was the primary reason. But there's also this thing called dark matter, which makes up about 80% of all the material in the universe. So let me give you a little video here. This is a simulation that dates back to 2006. But what I'm going to show you is a simulation of a galaxy growing. Okay? And this is not... All this material and the filaments you're about to see are not matter that, as we know it, it's dark matter. And it gives you a sense of how dark matter had an impact on the formation of galaxies. And you can see, we're seeing little mergers here going on. There's small dwarf galaxies are being pulled into the larger galaxy at the center of the picture by gravity, and by dark matter. Dark matter added to the gravity and the pull, therefore, of that central galaxy. Now, this film spans a period of billions of years. But this is how science, this is the standard model, this is how science believes the universe and the galaxies that inhabit the universe were formed. Now, there's two types of mergers that can occur. The first one is a major merger, and here's an example of that. A major merger is where you've got two big galaxies, and they start to get close to each other, right? And then they start to tear each other apart gravitationally. You've probably heard that, you know, billions of years from now, the Andromeda galaxy and the Milky Way galaxy are going to merge, and they're going to do one of these things. They're just going to, like, psst, all over the place. You know, what's interesting is when these mergers take place, the stars generally don't collide with each other because the distances between the stars is actually so vast that they just sort of pass by each other. But as far as the shape of the galaxies, you know, the shapes get way distorted. You know, but over a period of billions of years, they combine and they end up forming a larger galaxy that is equal, or not equal, but close to the same mass as the two original galaxies. All right, so that's a major merger. Then there are minor mergers. And here's an example of that. So again, you've got a large spiral galaxy in the center. You've got these irregular dwarf galaxies that are in orbit about the large spiral. And over time, the gravity of the large spiral starts to draw in those smaller galaxies. And of course, they become distorted. And you see they put out these streams, almost like a contrail from an airplane. You know, and what those are stars that are sort of being left and represent their final orbits. But over time, as these minor mergers occur, the large spiral grows. That's how the Milky Way grew. That's how Andromeda Galaxy grew, through a series of minor mergers. So according to standard model, major mergers are very rare now. These don't happen that often at all. In the past, minor mergers were very common. And what they produced were fossilized stellar streams, okay? And you saw some of that, those little contrails I was talking about. And so stellar streams that are evidence of minor mergers. Now here's the trick. Until the 1990s, this theory had never been proven. I mean, science believed, accepted this theory, but there had never been any proof of a stellar stream anywhere. And so, you know, there were a lot of people starting to look for them. Very difficult to find them, though, because of their dimness. Since the 90s, stellar streams have been found around the Milky Way and the Andromeda Galaxy. So here's an example of some of the kind of fossils that survive these minor mergers. And as you know, there's various different kinds of shapes. All this is particle. These are all stars that have been left behind by the dwarf galaxy as it merged into the parent galaxy. The first stellar stream to be discovered was the Magellanic star stream. It was discovered in 1994. It's about 52,000 light years from the center of the Milky Way. And it was the first time that we have proof that our galaxy had consumed another galaxy. And relatively speaking, here's where the sun is. Here's where the Magellanic stellar stream is located. It's in down Sagittarius. And this little movie gives you sort of another view of it. It's very faint, it's very sparse. It was very difficult to discover. So why are they so difficult? Well, they're hard to discover for several reasons. One, the local streams, the ones around the Milky Way, are all resolvable into stars. The problem is the stars are very dim, and it's not like you see this, you know, stream of stars that sort of looks like someone took a brush and painted it. They're very sparse. And it took a lot of observations to notice that this star and that star and that star and that star and that star, they all seem to be going the same direction. And that's why it took so long to discover the stream in the Milky Way. Because the low surface brightness and the fact that we're inside the galaxy looking out makes it very difficult. Streams around distant galaxies are difficult to resolve into stars because they're so far away. And because they're so faint, you've got to have extremely long exposures. Longer exposures than are typically taken by researchers using large telescopes, either because A, they're not looking for these streams, or B, even if they were, they don't have enough time to get the long exposure with the telescope.
Question?
Yes?
Backing up to those local streams,
mm-hmm.
How did they get the data on the proper motion and radial velocity?
The research started in the early 90s, and the paper wasn't released until 1994. And some of it was serendipity. And you know, once they started seeing that, there, you know, a handful of stars seemed to be moving in the same direction, they started to actually look for them, look for more. But you know, it was only like, I mean, it was less than 50 stars made up the complete data set. But what they found were they were all traveling same velocity, same direction, and it was in, and it was like a line.
It's a total needle in a haystack.
Yeah, and so far, we've only discovered one stellar stream around the Milky Way because, quite frankly, we're too close to it. So this logo represents the team of scientists that I work with and the project, which is a survey of stellar tidal streams. It is led by, and Linda mentioned his name, David Martinez-Delgado. He's currently at the University of Heidelberg. He's been studying stellar streams, I don't know, for about 15 years. He's considered the world's leading authority on this topic. Here are some of the other professional contributors that make up the team. They're from all over the world. And we also have an illustrator. This is a guy named John Lumberg, and I don't know if you remember Cosmos, the television program, Cosmos the book by Carl Sagan, also Contact. John Lumberg worked with Carl Sagan to create many of the illustrations that were used in Cosmos back in the late 70s, early 80s. John Lumberg also designed the golden record that's on the Voyager spacecraft, and John designed the logo that we're using for stellar stream. And I might note that what John is into these days is, this is his garden. He lives in Hawaii. This is his galaxy garden. And he's very proud of it. And he said that if I mention his name, I have to show off his garden. So let me get into how are we going about this research. We've identified 50 of the closest galaxies to the local group. We're taking long exposures, a minimum of 5 to 10 hours, without any filters, just clear filter exposures. If we see something, we take a confirmation image with another instrument to make sure that we're not just fooling ourselves into thinking there's something there that's actually not. We're also taking photometric measurements, so we understand exactly, you know, how far away is the stream. You know, are there any planetary nebula embedded in the stream? Things like that. Age of the stars, metallicity of the stars. We generally follow up once we think we have a discovery. We will go and get time on a professional telescope. And now that we know what we're looking for and know exactly where to look for it, we'll go take a confirmation image. And the purpose of the confirmation image is not to replicate the image that we took with a small instrument. It's just to go even get just a slice of that stream, just to prove it's there. What I've learned from working with professional astronomers is that they are very, very cautious. They're scared to death that they're going to scream eureka and prove them to be wrong. And you know, and also what I've learned from working with scientists is the whole way that they do that their career works is they write a paper, and then their paper is quoted by another paper, and that's how science builds our web of knowledge. In other words, I will write a paper based upon some research that you did, and that you reported in a paper, and so you know they become the foundation of a building that is ever growing. And the last thing that they want to have happen is that 50 years from now, someone finds out that their research was wrong, because that means that affects 50 years worth of other people's research. So they're very cautious. Let me give you some. Now, what I want to do now is give you some survey previews, things that we're working on. Right. This is NGC 5861 in Libra. This is an image taken, it's a 9-hour exposure. It's taken by my telescope. You can see the stream here, right? Sort of looks like a geyser. Now, just to prove that's real, we got time on a 4-meter telescope over in the Canary Islands, the William Herschel at the William Herschel Observatory. And of course, it only took 3 hours. But as you can see, it also got the strain. Now, the difference in the two images is the fact that the William Herschel could do it in 3 hours. With my telescope, it took 9 hours. But as you can see, even a small telescope, though, can do some pretty good work compared to a great big one. And the resolution, of course, on the William Herschel is much, much better because it's a bigger telescope. Here's another preview. This is a 4-hour exposure of M83, and Hydra is a fairly familiar galaxy. It's sort of down the southern sky. But as you can see, here's a portion of the stream that's surrounding M83, and no one expected M83 to have a stream around it. This is M102. It's in Draco, and again, you can see the streams, these coming out like this from the corner, edges of the galaxy. So not all stellar streams are circles. There are different types of streams, and I'm going to explain that to you in just a moment. But again, you know, this is we're working on these papers. This is NGC 3521 in LEO. I like to call it the bubble galaxy because it's got all of these shells surrounding it. And those shells are remnants of mergers in the distant past. This is what that picture looks like in color. One of the things that I get to do is, the scientists use black and white photographs, and the color doesn't do anything for their research. But one of the things I get to do is I get to take the same picture that I did help them in their research, and I get to go add color to it and make it look more interesting, because a lot of times scientific images, quite frankly, are ugly. If you saw some of the images that these guys work with, that I take, they're really, I don't think they're attractive at all. My wife definitely doesn't see what I see in them. But I can take that same image, add some color to it, tone it down a little bit, and produce something like this. So let me go into some results, things that we've actually written papers on. The first one is NGC 4013. It's a diamond ring galaxy in Ursa Major. And the reason it's called diamond ring galaxy is because there's this bright star that's actually in the Milky Way that's sort of superimposed in our line of sight to the much more distant galaxy. And it's sort of like flashy diamond ring, right? In and of itself, it's a cool looking galaxy. But if you go, and here it is in context, in the field of stars that surround it, right? But if you go really deep, you'll find this got this loop.
Wow.
Okay. And this was actually our first discovery. They had suspected this. They had been using a telescope, one of the telescopes down at the NOAA observatory in New Mexico. But they hadn't gone deep enough. They weren't sure, was it noise, whatever. And so this is one of the first images they asked me to actually go and prove.
Question?
Yeah.
What's the distance to that object, and how big is it?
I don't know how far it is to this galaxy. It's, hundreds of light years, or millions of light years, actually. I can tell you, though, that if you consider that this galaxy is fairly the size of the Milky Way, similar to the size of the Milky Way, and you look at the size of this structure, it actually dwarfs the galaxy. These streams are humongous. Here's a little animation that sort of gives you an idea of how did that thing form. This was done by one of the research folks. So if you would imagine the galaxy's in the center of all this, what you're seeing there is the satellite galaxy, the dwarf galaxy, in its final orbits, as before it merged with the parent galaxy. I'll run it one more time, and it leaves this stellar stream of stars. And generally, the stars in these stellar streams are very old. They're very old stars. They're red, They've got a lot of metal in them. Okay. This is NGC 5907. This is probably our biggest discovery. And it's called the Splinter Galaxy, and the people who like to take astronomical photos, amateurs, they enjoy taking a picture of this galaxy. It's because it's very simple. Yes?
What causes the stars to be left behind?
That's a good question. If you would, think of how the moon and the earth interact and the way it causes tides. Right? So as the moon pulls, the ocean on the moon facing side outward, it pulls the earth a little ways, and you create these tidal effects, right? So the same thing happens as these satellite galaxies are orbiting the parent galaxy, the spiral, is it is gravitationally distorting the dwarf galaxy, and it's slowly nudging stars closer to the spiral. And over time, those stars are actually pop out of the gravitational field of the dwarf and are left behind. Okay, and you start to get this stream, and this particularly becomes pronounced the closer the dwarf gets to the parent galaxy. Because literally the parent galaxy, it doesn't just gobble this round thing. It literally distorts it, just obliterates any shape to it. And this sort of consumes stars, individual stars. But some of the stars are still left in this final orbit, if you would. And eventually they do that decays. They do also fall into the parent. If you notice, there's this object right here. And it was discovered actually by some folks at an observatory over in China in the late 90s. But they couldn't explain what it was. In fact, they weren't even sure if it was even there. They simply mentioned it in their paper. This is a fairly deep image, and I was able to capture that same thing. The team of scientists I worked with said, we want you to go really deep on this thing. We think there's more. We think this is a string, but we can't prove that. So I went deep, and that's what I saw. Loops. Not to say loop, but loops, loop to loops. And the research that we've done on this set of data that's in this image indicates it was one merger. There was one satellite galaxy formed that as it started to spiral into the parent. And here is sort of this is a from the paper on this galaxy. Give you a little bit better idea of exactly what those loops look like, and they're far bigger than the galaxy, and think how galaxies are big, and again this galaxy is similar in size to the Milky Way, so these are huge structures. Here's a little animation of how we think that happened. Again, you imagine the galaxies in the center. We've not been able to find the progenitor. In other words, this dark blob here, we haven't been able to find that. So we can't find evidence of, where's the kernel of the original little satellite that formed that. At least it's from our data, it's been obliterated. It's gone.
Do you remember how many hours this photo
was? Yeah, this photo was about, 15, 16 hours, just for the black and white images. Not the color added much more, but it's very deep.
How many days or does it typically take to 15 or 16 hours?
Typically our work on one of these images for about at the very least a month because of weather. I've got to not only get clear skies, but I've got to get steady skies where there's not a lot of twinkling and so forth. Some of these images were required multiple years. In other words, I would take some 1 year. We'd look at them and decide that, let's see if we can see any more if we go deeper, if we take longer exposure. And so some of these images end up adding up. Like this picture that I'll show you is a 24-hour picture. This is a sunflower galaxy. It's a very popular image for amateur astrophotographers. It's bright. It's interesting. If you read the literature, this is known as a galaxy that is spinning so fast that all that material is being slung outside the galaxy. That's the explanation. Okay? That's the classic explanation. However, if you go deep on this galaxy, what you find is that all that material is not something that's being spun out of the galaxy. It's star streams surrounding the galaxy. And it's evidence, again, of where satellite galaxies, dwarf galaxies, have been pulled into this parent over billions of years. Now, let me show you some examples of the various types of structures that can result when these stellar mergers happen. So the galaxy, the parent galaxy is in the middle, and as you can see, as the satellites go in, sometimes they go right straight through the center, and they make these sort of bow shocks that goes, you know, bouncing back and forth. Some create, you know, stream-like loops. But there's much more to this than simply loops. There's a lot of different types of structures that can result. So here's an example of a different kind of structure. We call this the umbrella galaxy. And what's happened with the umbrella galaxy is at some point in the distant past, billions of years ago, a satellite came through the center of this galaxy, shot out the other side, reached a point where it was gravitationally attracted back in to the galaxy, but at that point, it created what looks like a bow shock. It's actually material from that satellite that got disrupted into a shell that's surrounding this galaxy, and what we're seeing here is one of the more denser part of the shell's edge on, so it's visible. And here's that same galaxy taken with the Subaru. Okay, so again, the Subaru shows the same structures that the picture I took shows with a 20-inch telescope. Subaru is much, much bigger. It's what, 383 inches in diameter, the mirror is. And yet, while the resolution's much better, and you know, the stars are much more finite, and there's more stars here, as far as research goes, it doesn't really show anything more than the deep image I took. Now, the difference here is this is the confirmation image. This image represents an exposure to the Subaru of about 20 minutes. Whereas my picture took, like, I don't know, 10 or 15 hours. And here's what we think is the path of the satellite that was disrupted as it passed through this galaxy. We've had some false positives. You know, we thought we saw structures that represented stellar mergers, and it turned out they didn't. The first one is M63. Again, a popular galaxy for astrophotographers, and it's what it's noted for is this sort of ring, this donut ring of material. And if you go on the internet, even with some very large telescopes, and you get it at, you know, Google M63, it'll show this sort of amorphous ring of material surrounding M63, and it's never really been explained. So I went deep on this image. And my exposure really, this is when I really stretched the exposure, this deep image, to see what all was in there. And as you can see, that there is some structure, it turns out, in that amorphous ring. And when I processed it, I got that. Spiral arms. They were simply hidden by dust and gas in the optical wavelength. So this is the picture that caught the astronomers' attention back in 2006 and prompted them to contact me to join their research, because they had never seen this image, an image like this before. And so what they did was they said, we've got to go, we're going to go prove that this image is real. So what they did was they got some time on various space telescopes. Well, first, we went and looked at some data that had been taken through the SDSS survey. And again, I was able to process it, and you can see that, you know, there is some structure even in that SDSS data. That no, people just overlooked it. But then we've got a hold of the Spitzer. And this is a 24 micron infrared. As you can see, what the Spitzer showed is there are spiral arms there. And then we had a 3.6 micron. Again, we are seeing spiral arms. At 8 micron, there are spiral arms. In fact, the spiral arms in the 8 micron very much resemble the optical spiral arms. And then we went to the Galax for infrared. And if you combine them all, you get that. That's multispectral. So it proves that the optical image that I produced that showed spiral arms was real. And my reward was I get to work with a bunch of professional astronomers for the last, since 2006. And to give you an idea how we think those spiral arms formed, we did a little model. This is a barred spiral, and we think the spiral arms are actually just extended spiral arms coming off because of the barred spiral and the velocity of the rotation of this galaxy. And the reason that no one had seen them previously again was they were enveloped in a cloud of dust and gas in the optical wavelength. Okay, so here's another false positive. So that galaxy turns out didn't have star string, but it had spiral arms. All right, here's another galaxy. This is this is Bode's Nebula, Bode's Galaxy, right? M81. And one of the things that's always been curious about this galaxy is that in pictures, deep pictures of this galaxy, there's always these filaments, vertical filaments, going up and down, sort of dark, right? And the classic explanation of Bode's galaxy for these filaments is that it is a result of interactions with a nearby galaxy that came too close billions of years ago. That galaxy is called M82. Or it's also known as the exploding galaxy or the cigar galaxy. So they've always, the literature's always said, well, these filaments, you know, is a result of that interaction. All right, so we did some research on this, and what we discovered was that was wrong. That in fact, this structure is actually part of the Milky Way. It's actually just right outside the Milky Way. And it is by chance along our line of sight to M81. It has absolutely nothing to do with M81. It has nothing to do with interaction between M81 and M82, another galaxy. So again, we didn't find a stellar stream, but we did find something else. We proved something else.
So that's the external circuit as well as the line in the
middle. Yeah. Well, if you notice, what we've got here is the line. These lines are actually just where the light from the galaxy are backlighting this dust and gas, and so that all you're seeing is the more dense parts. Okay. You know, so when you think about it that way, suddenly you go, oh yeah, that makes sense. Some recent research results. This is the Whale Galaxy in Canis Venatici. The Whale Galaxy is kind of cool because it's an edge one. And it does, it has this satellite that is in it is interacting with the parent. It's been known for a long time that the Whale Galaxy has a bar of material connecting it to another galaxy. Again, it was assumed that this was due to interaction between this galaxy and another nearby galaxy, right? What we found was that no, that this is actually the one portion of a stellar strain. And here's sort of a view to give you more context. The lower portion of the stream has been known for years. Its explanation has been wrong, but we discovered this upper portion of the stream. In the process of all this, we also discovered three new satellite galaxies that no one had ever seen before. And here's the other galaxy nearby that it was always assumed was responsible for this structure, and it turns out no. This structure is strictly a result of a merger with the Whale Galaxy billions of years ago. It has absolutely nothing to do with the other galaxy, which is known as the Hockey Stick Galaxy. I guess because it looks like a hockey stick. Here's the Silver Dollar Galaxy in Sculptors. Silver Dollar Galaxy is a really cool galaxy because it's got all these hairy filaments sticking up from it. It's considered to be an active galaxy. These filaments are the result of very furious star or stellar birth going on all across the disk of this galaxy. Here's a more close-up of all these filaments. But what we found was we found a new satellite, which you can see it here in context. And here's a close-up of that portion of the image. And this is a proof of it taken with a Subaru telescope. So again, we're looking for stellar streams and we end up finding new galaxies, new dwarf galaxies. It happens. Finally, this is NGC 4449. It's an irregular galaxy. It's fairly nearby. And what's cool about this galaxy is it is a small dwarf galaxy. Okay, in and of itself, it's not a big galaxy. But what is different about this is that it's the first dwarf galaxy that we've ever discovered that has a stream. So here's proof of a dwarf that resulted from the merger with some other dwarf that was even smaller. So this was an image taken through my pea shooter telescope. This is the same view taken through the Subaru, and again, there you can see how the Subaru just brings out all sorts of more stars. It's got much better resolution. But again, you know, it was a proof that, you know, this stream is actually for real. One of the nice things about, you know, being able to get a big telescope, you know, like the Subaru, to take one of these images, is that it allows, you know, the resolution of it can sometimes be breathtaking. And you know, these stellar streams, the reason they're called streams is because they're like a stream of stars, right? A river of stars. Well, with NGC 4449, we were able to resolve this stellar stream. The first time we were able to resolve a stellar stream into individual stars. And as you can see, it is a river of stars. You know, it's just hundreds of thousands of old stars that make up this stream. There's another view of it, even more clear. So the work's been exciting. You never know what you're going to discover. You know, generally, when the scientists ask me to go take a picture, they don't tell me what they're looking for. They don't tell me where to look, other than go for this galaxy. And so for me, it's always interesting to, you know, finally pull a picture together and see something, and, you know, and realize that maybe I'm the first person to see this thing. And of course, when I show it to scientists, they freak out. And the first thing they say is, don't show this to anyone. You know, I've had to sit on pictures for like 3 or 4 years. I mean, just waiting for them to get all their research done and actually publish a paper. But this is one that they flipped out over really a lot because they've been called, it's always been called a river of stars. But again, it was theoretically a river of stars. This proved it. I just want to give some citations for the images that some of the images that I used in this presentation. And this is my website. And if you ever have a chance to have nothing else to do, you ought to bop over there and just take a look at some of the pictures I've taken. That's it. Questions? Yeah.
Thank you for your presentation. I'm wondering if you're aware of any other amateur astronomers that were professionals who were here.
You know, we have brought in some other amateurs into the research that I'm doing. Because they basically keep coming up with more targets than I can even keep up with. So we do, there were about six or seven guys. They change from time to time because, a lot of amateur astrophotographers, they do one of these pictures and then they're told to not even publish it for years. And that's not what, they're more into taking the pictures and publishing the pictures. So they'll join us for, one project and then they sort of leave. It's difficult to get a professional scientist to work with an amateur because they're scared to death that the amateur is going to, A, shoot their mouth off and blow this secret because, it's very competitive and reveal something they're doing research on to, a competing team. Or they're afraid the amateur is going to, show this, before all the research is done and claim it to be something that it turns out not to be. So there's a lot of fear of that. And so I've always said that the guys I work with are some of the most courageous astronomers in the world because they're willing to work with an amateur. But so for that reason, there aren't a lot of, there's not a lot of this going on. I mean, there's stuff going on in the exoplanet research to some extent, but by and large, there is this gulf between professional and amateur, and it's called fear. Yeah.
I'm just curious about maintenance and upkeep of your scope because you're located far away. How do you keep everything operational?
Okay, great question. I'm actually located in a place where service is provided. So it's called Sierra Remote Observatories, and it's a group of doctors who bought some property, and they've literally got about 10 observatory buildings, and they furnish the building and internet and electricity, and you furnish everything else, right? And they have a technician who lives nearby so that if you have an emergency, like it's starting to snow and the roof of your observatory won't close, you can call this person at 3 o'clock in the morning and say, will you please go close my roof, I can't get it closed. And so that's good enough, and that technician can do small repairs.
Have you looked at any much rarer major mergers?
On a major merger, major mergers took place long ago in the past. There are a lot of tidal interactions that are out there. To be observed, galaxies who gravitational big galaxies interacting with each other, but they do not lend evidence to the type of research that my group of scientists is looking for. They're looking for evidence of these minor mergers because it is fundamental to the standard model, and according to them. At least we should be able to see a stellar stream around 30% of all the galaxies within 50 closest galaxies. And where we're running at right now so far is we're at about 25%. Okay, theoretically they said we should be able to get 30. And part of the problem that we're starting to bump up against is sky glow. There's a certain point where my exposures go so deep that I actually start to capture just the glow in the atmosphere. We also have a challenge with interstellar dust. Interstellar dust is also capable of masking out some of these more distant star streams. So that's the challenge that we're facing right now is 25% the most we will ever be able to observe? Because theoretically they say we should be able to get up to 33. So that's really what the focus right now is what techniques can we use to go deeper? Without getting crazy about it. Yeah.
How does the two galaxies merge? How do they get rid of their angular momentum so that they would not ordinarily just pass right through and continue on their way? In order to bring them to coalesce, they would have to lose some of that energy. But since there's so much space between the stars themselves never really
touch.
Collide. So well, what sort of reduces the angular momentum so it essentially will compact?
Right. Well, if you saw, I had an animation of a major merger, two big galaxies, and as they approached each other, they started to distort, and that's just, and eventually they came apart, and then they started coming back together, and they sort of this boing, 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 and you end up with an elliptical galaxy when it's all over with, right? They both of them lost all their shape, right? And so that the energy you're talking about, you know, is transferred into that distortion, that distortion, okay? And of course, the events happens over hundreds of millions of years. With a minor merger, because of the vast differences in mass between the parent galaxy and the satellite galaxy, part of the angular momentum is lost through the streams, okay? That results in the streams. But again, you know, mostly with a minor merger, the smaller galaxy, you know, it gets completely distorted, and it just falls into the halo of the larger galaxy. Yeah. Yeah. Let me end my show. You talking about this one? Is this the one?
Nothing on this screen.
Oh, I've been turned off. Am I unplugged?
Try to unplug it in and plug it back.
Oh.
Give me a few seconds.
There. This one? That one right there? Okay, so what was the question? That's M104. Oh, no. That is not the sombrero. Maybe I have mislabeled. M106. That should be M106. Thank you. You're right. It's not that. M104 is the sombrero. I mislabeled this. Hey, I'm an amateur. What do you expect? Perfection? Yeah.
Well, first of all, I just want you to think that I get a lot of say you must have the best job ever. I was wondering if this is the only project that you're working on, or do you also have like a lot of scientists lining up to you?
Oh, you know, I've had other scientists approach me and actually wanted to do galactic research, and I've turned them down because I didn't want to find myself compromising this team. And besides that, David, the lead researcher, threatened me at the very beginning of my relationship. He said, if you ever work with another team that's doing the same thing, I'll throw you out of our group. So I said, okay, don't worry about that. I won't do it. I'll keep it to myself. But I mean, I have a regular day job. I mean, this is what I do. This is my hobby, I guess. You know, I've actually worked down in Silicon Valley, and I work for a company called Equinix, which is the world's largest provider of data centers. So I have a regular day job as well as this, you know, which is like crazy sometimes. Yeah.
Just a question about image processing software.
Uh-huh. Well, I use software to actually capture the image with the camera, and it's called Maxim DL. It's off the shelf. And then there's a variety of different software that I use at various steps in my processing. I use something called CCD Stack. I use something called PixInsight. I'll use Photoshop. I've spent over 500 hours on a picture because I'm just not satisfied with it, or I see something and I'm trying to bring it out, make it more clear. Because I feel that if you don't grasp something like in 3 seconds when you first look at these pictures, you ain't gonna see it. So I feel it's really important to get that contrast at the right level. So I'll throw everything I got at it. But I would say once I get it out of the camera and get it dark subtracted and flat filled and all that, so it's ready for a lot of processing, I use Photoshop.
You'll all be pleased to know that this was recorded back there. So you'll be able to go to Archive, SFAA website, and be able to see it. And of course, you do go to Cosmotography. And here is your third, with an image that Jay took.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you. It's in an upcoming publication that I put in here. It's going to talk about as if this were just happening right now, but it's the coming year going to be in another publication. Thank you so very much.
Thank you.